has been taught to fly. This is an American football field. If you put the goalposts here and here and the stadium around it, the horizontal stabilizer would be up in the bleachers.
The KM was a massive low-flying craft that flew barely 60 feet over the water. Nikita Khrushchev hoped it would give the Soviet Union a decisive military advantage over the West. He envisaged a fleet of ekranoplans that would fly below radar detection at jet-like speeds, carrying hundreds of troops and their equipment, or a battery of intermediate-range missiles right up to enemy shores. The ekranoplan was the brainchild of Rostislav Alexeyev, a brilliant and visionary hydrofoil designer who'd long dreamed of boats that flew. Alexeyev dazzled Khrushchev with the military potential of his ideas and was given a green light to build one of the largest flying machines the world had ever seen. When Khrushchev came to power in 1953, Stalin's notoriously repressive regime gave way to a more relaxed and open leadership. A period of relative freedom for new thinking and new ideas was ushered in.
Stalin believed that the way you ran the country was to scare the living daylights out of everybody. Khrushchev believed that the terror had basically knocked the spirit out of the country, so that unless it was relaxed, nothing could be done.
Khrushchev was a simple man who enjoyed simple pleasures. His more conservative Politburo colleagues would later accuse him of dragging them into adventures that led nowhere. But behind the Kremlin walls, Khrushchev was deadly serious.
Khrushchev took power at a particular difficult moment. That was when the U.S. had a rather huge nuclear monopoly. Therefore, he had a sense of desperation about finding ways to compensate for their military inadequacies.
At the United Nations, Khrushchev once bragged that Russia had ships that could jump over bridges. Nobody knew what he meant. Khrushchev wasn't the only one talking in code. The mere mention of the word ekranoplan was a jailable offense.
We were surprised to hear that everyone was talking about some kind of steamboat.
Tatiana is the daughter of the renowned ekranoplan designer, and she worked alongside her father as his assistant.
I found out that steamboat was the ekranoplan. There was a scandal in the ministry because father used to say it during secret conferences. They got very angry with him for speaking disrespectfully.
Annoying his superiors was not uncommon for Alexeyev. With his cocky demeanor and good looks, he often clashed with his bosses. But Alexeyev was determined to realize his dreams. He was a free, some might say stubborn thinker in a closed society. Stalin had imprisoned his father for 3 years because of his aristocratic origins. While at best indifferent to communist ideology, Alexeyev was a true Russian patriot who wanted to do good for his country. Alexeyev had a passion for sports, motorcycling, skiing, but most of all he loved boats and speed. The course of his life was set when he built his first boat by hand at the age of 22. From then on, he resolved to take boats faster and faster, so fast they flew. Alexeyev set up his design bureau in Nizhny Novgorod. During the Soviet period, it was known as Gorky, an important military industrial center, completely off limits to foreigners and Russians without special passes. Alexeyev was a pioneer in the development of hydrofoils, and despite having to work through the cumbersome Soviet bureaucracy, he became one of the world's leading designers. But by the 1950s, he had developed another idea, the ekranoplan. Alexander Moskalik was, from the earliest days, Alexeyev's chief scientist.
It's no coincidence that in the course of his life, Alexeyev made two inventions. The first was a ship with wings placed underwater. The second was with wings above the water. He made a logical switch from movement through the water to movement through the air.
Alexeyev had the funding to build small ekranoplan models on his own. But to properly test his ideas, he would need a huge injection of funds. Like all Soviet design bureaus, Alexeyev had to continually fight for resources from a rigidly centralized planned economy that favored military over civilian projects.
Their system favored military over civilian, totally. It wasn't guns or butter, it was guns give you butter. It was a military-led society. Stalin produced such a society.
Alexeyev had never been a military type. But to get the funding he needed, he knew he would have to show the ekranoplan had military applications. In the aftermath of Stalin's regime of terror, he would find a receptive ear in the heart of the Kremlin. Khrushchev's consolidation of power during the 1950s would provide the opportunity Alexeyev was looking for. Khrushchev was an innovator who planned to challenge the West with bold and fearsome projects. Like the Sputnik launch in 1957, they were intended to show off Soviet technological superiority.
He was, if you like, a technology freak. He believed that deterrence could work, and that made him really like examples of high technology that would impress the West. Not only do spectacular projects pay off big, but you don't have to have a lot of them.
Alexeyev and other designers were given direct access to Khrushchev to pitch their ideas and lobby for money. If, like the famed Soviet aircraft maker Andrei Tupolev, Alexeyev could convince Khrushchev that one throw of the dice could change the East-West balance, the financial tap would open. In 1960, Alexeyev made a personal appeal to Khrushchev at a party meeting. Alexander Moskalik was there.
He went up to Alexeyev and shook his hand and thanked him for coming. This is how their relationship began.
Alexeyev proposed what would be a technological marvel, a fleet of enormous flying ships that would exploit some of the most revolutionary aerodynamic theories. Khrushchev loved it.
Of all the people I've met in government, I have never seen anyone's eyes light up more than Khrushchev's when talking about technology.
Alexeyev and Khrushchev were kindred spirits, each willing to take big risks for their ideas. Alexeyev was the artist, and Khrushchev became his patron.
It was amazing how two people could understand each other right away. Khrushchev was extremely excited, and he drew up a personal contract for Alexeyev.
For the next 6 years, Alexeyev worked feverishly to perfect his theories and construct the first large-scale ekranoplan, the KM. He knew that because of water resistance, boats and hydrofoils could only move so fast. To go faster, his boats would have to leave the water completely. To this end, Alexeyev developed a thorough understanding of an aerodynamic phenomenon known as ground effect, a sensation of riding on a cushion of air long noticed by pilots when landing. Alexeyev turned what pilots had long considered simply an annoyance into a technology that could revolutionize the performance of ships. But there was one problem. How would they get it out of the water? Alexeyev's solution was to put massive engines at the front of the fuselage. Their powerful exhausts would be blown under the wings, creating a temporary hovercraft. As speed increased, the entire ship would lift out of the water and ground effect would take over. After 6 years of costly development, the KM was rolled out of its hangar in Gorky and sent down the River Volga to its testing site on the Caspian Sea. On October the 11th, 1966, it made its first flight. Dmitry Garbuzov and Vitaly Peshinov were the pilot and co-pilot. Alexeyev sat between them, controlling the engines. The eight front engines roared to life, propelling the KM forward and out of the water. At 540 tons, it was 150 tons heavier than the future Boeing 747 and larger than a B-52. The tail was 5 stories high. It was by far the biggest and heaviest creation ever to take off. For Dmitry Gabuzov, the test pilot, it was a memorable day.
You noticed how the seagulls flapped to get out of your way. The machine flew frighteningly low. Everyone was amazed by how such a cumbersome contraption could fly.
The first flight was a resounding success, and hopes ran high for the KM's military applications. Later tests proved it could fly at more than 400 miles an hour. There were no press announcements of the KM's maiden flight, or any other ekranoplan flight. Everything about it was hidden behind an impenetrable veil of secrecy. But what Alexeyev and his team never knew was that they were being observed by American intelligence. In the late 1950s, the U-2 spy plane provided the United States with valuable information about the Soviet Union. When U-2 pilot Gary Powers was shot down and captured in 1960, the spy flights came to an immediate halt. But with the launch of the top-secret Corona reconnaissance satellite, vast expanses of the Soviet Union could be photographed from the safe vantage of space. One day in 1966, Stephen Hooker and his team of Corona photo analysts, by chance, noticed a strange-looking craft at an old Second World War submarine plant on the western shore of the Caspian Sea, a craft that was too big to be hidden.
They had no choice with something this size but to hope that they could put it somewhere where they wouldn't expect us to be wasting our film.
Unaware of what they were looking at, they called it the Caspian Sea Monster.
The first question that came up was, is it a complete aircraft? It looks, after all, like the wings are missing. So we put wings on it, and when we did that, it turned out not to be a very good performing airplane, having many meetings.
But why build an aircraft that couldn't fly? Through models and extensive tests, Hooker and his colleagues deduced it was a ground effect aircraft. The US government kept the secret until the end of the Cold War. Back in Russia, Alexeyev succeeded in mastering ground effect. Ekranoplans could fly more efficiently than high-flying planes, and this foreshadowed the development of even larger and more threatening craft.
It didn't escape their notice that this scales to larger and larger sizes. Suppose you built a large vessel to deploy troops. Suppose you built something twice the size of KM and now carried 500-600 troops in it, and with that their full complement of armor and so forth, perhaps 1,000–1,500 tons.
But what Alexeyev and American intelligence experts did not know was that by its first flight in 1966, the KM and Alexeyev's grand ambitions were already doomed. In 1964, 2 years before the first flight of the KM ekranoplan, Rostislav Alexeyev's benefactor Nikita Khrushchev was deposed from power by Leonid Brezhnev. The political climate changed dramatically, and the winds quickly turned against Alexeyev. Risk-taking, like putting missiles in Cuba, was out. Conservative orthodoxy and gradualism were now the order of the day.
Brezhnev came along, and he and Kosygin accused Khrushchev of harebrained scheming, of adventurism, taking too big a risk. We've got to settle back, cross the board, build real military power that transcends the capitalist camp's power.
Khrushchev's unorthodox experiments, like the ekranoplan, were out of favor.
We had a chance to show Brezhnev our work. When we began to show our film footage, he sat, fell asleep, then asked, "When's lunch?"
Alexeyev, the maverick, had lost his direct access to the top. Brezhnev returned control of the ekranoplan project to a once bypassed and now hostile ministry, eager for revenge. In 1968, When the testing of the KM was at its most intense, Alexeyev was summoned to Moscow and removed as head of his own